Hello, everyone. Happy Thursday. How's everyone feeling? Alive? Lots of coffee? Hair of the dog? For anybody who doesn't know, I'm Zan Rowe. I'm the host of Mornings on Triple J. And it's a really great honour to introduce our keynote speaker this afternoon, a writer whose work very much started conversations and continues to. She's educated many and she's inspired many, many more over two decades of music journalism. Jessica Hopper is first and foremost a music fan. She began her career in music journalism writing a fanzine in her hometown of Minneapolis because that's what you did. You got involved. You had to be part of that community. And Hit It or Quit It really kicked off what would be a lifelong exploration of music, of community, of gender, and of fandom. For a while, Jessica actually worked as a publicist for bands, and she even jumped on stage and literally flipped that musician-critic equation as a bass player herself. Published everywhere from Spin to Rookie Magazine to the LA Weekly to the Chicago Tribune and many more in between. In 2009, she published The Girl's Guide to Rocking and has been featured multiple times in the best music writing anthologies over the years. Hopper's work has been celebrated most recently in a book that captures this history, almost two decades of it, titled The First Collection of Criticism by a Living Female Rock Critic. It's a book that after I read it, I wanted to recommend to every single person that I knew. And if you haven't read it, it's amazing. Whether you're a feminist or not, whether you're a music fan or not, it's just an incredible read. Her day job right now is as senior editor for Pitchfork Online, and she's also the editor-in-chief for the Pitchfork Review. And what I love about Jessica Hopper's writing is that she asks the questions that many today are just too afraid to ask. So I hope that she challenges us to do that today in this room. Please make her very, very welcome to Big Sound and back to Australia, Jessica Hopper.
Hello, thank you. So before I get started, I just want to say a little something about what I'm going to talk about. I'm not going to tell you how to get your band best new music on Pitchfork. My talk today is about how we can all be part of a solution. That's my hope. So, about 2 weeks ago, I was getting ready to come do this talk, and I was talking to my colleague, the critic Molly Beauchemin, who I work with at Pitchfork, and we were talking about what I was going to talk about today, and it was sort of about women in the music industry, because I know this is primarily a music industry conference, and I said, you know, I've been really fortunate that I've had largely positive experiences. I know that I've had, you know, some of the same experiences that like every woman in the music industry has, I said, but you know, my curiosity as a teenage girl about music was met with incredible encouragement by the grown-ups and by men and people that I worked with around me when I was just getting into music. So I kind of had a slightly unusual experience in that way, is that I felt encouraged. And as a result, then, you know, anything that came my way later that sort of diminished my right to be involved in music, I had something to counterbalance it. I knew that it fundamentally wasn't true. And she said, well, why don't you crowdsource what women's experiences and stories are about their initial forays into music and the ways that they were discouraged. So I sent a tweet. I don't know if you guys read this one. So I sent this tweet, and you know, I wasn't just addressing women. I was also just trying to be inclusive. You know, lots of people aren't exactly welcomed into music and its spaces necessarily. And at first I got about like 50 or 60 replies, and they were, you know, things that I anticipated getting, people saying, you know, oh, I showed up for soundcheck and you know, basically someone told me how to set up my own equipment and, you know, all this. And so I started retweeting them. And what happened was, I didn't quite anticipate what would happen, which is that within 24 hours, thousands of replies came in. And then within 3 days, you know, it was basically like every 24 hours, it was at least doubling. And then by the second day, you know, Newsweek and The Guardian and major newspapers across the world had picked it up. People were then replying to the tweets and retweeting them in Swedish, in German, in Spanish, and it went worldwide. And I don't know if anybody was following this on the internet, so pardon me if I'm doing the full recap. And what we learned pretty quickly was that thousands and thousands of women involved in music have had similar experiences, as you can see. So I'm just gonna let that cruise through. For those of us that work in the industry, these tweets were exactly what you would expect. Women repeatedly shared stories of being mistaken for groupies or girlfriends of the band at shows where they, in fact, were headlining. Female journalists were consistently having their credentials called into question by male interviewees and their editors, to say nothing of the condescension or flirtation that was delivered often by these same men. There are tales of groping in the photo pit, but possibly the most heartbreaking of these stories are the subtle, backhanded insults that often would come in the form of compliments. Like the instance when one would-be writer was told by a male teacher that her work was, quote, feminine, but somehow still strong, as if those two attributes could not exist together. Reading those replies were heartbreaking, but they were also powerful and potent. Another writer told me that she had felt isolated in her experiences working until reading these. But given the sheer number of people eager to share their stories, we in fact see something else, something bigger. As my friend Drew Daniel of Motmos tweeted, we see that these are not isolated incidences. These issues are, in fact, systemic. And we can tell by these tweets in other languages too that these problems are, in fact, worldwide. So it begs the question, how exactly did it get like this? How did we get here? Sometime in the gulf between Beatlemania and Biebermania, we've lost sight of the enduring capacity that young women have to anticipate, sustain, and add cultural value to the experience of music. The term fangirl tends to be a pejorative one. It's associated with somehow a lesser experience of music, as if teen girls, in all of their riotous enthusiasm, are simply undermining the point. As artists are made less important by that fangirl excitement, which is reduced and delegitimized as hysterical or silly or, worst of all, stupid. Their interest is assumed to be based on the glimmering surfaces or their attraction to the artist, rather than what they actually get from the music or the concerts or the fan communities that they are part of. Their interest is seen as an adoration that spoils the credibility of the artists that they love. Yet, teen girls make the biggest market of music consumers in the world today. According to a study by the Parks Associates, women are not only one half of the world's population, but they also consume more music than men. So the question then remains, why doesn't music culture writ large, from the labels to the publications to the tech industry, production, studios, live concert venues, why aren't these places taking fangirls seriously? Why do women in music still, in 2015, a full 63 years since Big Mama Thornton recorded Hound Dog, one of our earliest rock and roll songs, why do women feel like they don't belong here? Women are marginalized in music in much the same way that women in sports are marginalized. It happens at all levels, from talent to the managerial side, to the media, and to the fandom that surrounds that. Our misguided perceptions of fangirls often start at the top. There's this pernicious idea that women shouldn't immerse themselves fully into art or business as men do. There's a suggestion that, like sports, working as an artist is physically and mentally taxing, that touring and being a creator requires a confidence, a mental fortitude, and a fuck-all bravado that women simply cannot hack. The typical wartime illusions apply that if you can't make it, that if you want to make it, you have to be tough. Now, I had an experience early on that countered all of this. I came into music knowing better than this. When I was 15 and 16 years old, I worked as an intern at Amphetamine Reptile Records, which is a old American indie label that was known for being macho. It was run by men, and I think there was maybe one woman on the entire roster out of, you know, like 40, 50 dudes. But the people that I worked for, the people that I spent my summer afternoons assembling, you know, mail order for, were men that valued my interest, that never once mocked my curiosity. The president of the company would periodically come and fill mail order with me and answer whatever questions I had about the music industry, about what we were doing, really specific questions about artists. And the people I worked with were accessible to me, they were encouraging to me, and moreover, they were protective of me in a way that was not, it didn't belittle my own personal strength or will as a person. While I was there, one day working as, you know, I did, basically like putting stamps on helmet records, and a well-known indie rock producer at the time, who's powerful and friends with all the people that work there, basically sexually harassed me, tried to paw me, just be gross to me. I was 15 or 16 at the time. And because of the relationship that I had with my bosses and the people that I worked with, I could go to them and say, this happened to me. I mean, I wasn't completely fearless about it. I was really freaked out about it. And my boss's reaction, which was relayed to me, I didn't see it, unfortunately, told me what I needed to know about these men that I was around and the value that I had. And supposedly my boss found this person who did this. My boss was an ex-Marine. Do you guys have Marines here? Threw him up against a wall, pinned him up by his neck, and said if he ever so much as talked to me again, he would fucking kill him. And apparently that person believed him because that person who was thrown against the wall is a bouncer at a bar near my house, and 20 years later he pretends like he doesn't know me. So it was effective, in case anyone's looking for a technique. But because of that, and because I worked at record stores with men who would say, oh, you like this? If you like this record, you're gonna love this album. If you like this, you're gonna, here, have this, you know, look blue, go purple, 12-inch. You'll love it, you know, and people who helped me understand that I had a right to be there, and they encouraged it. And so when people who were basically assholes to me or tried to diminish my right to be there, I could counter. I knew instinctively that's not true because I had this precedent with men that valued my simply being around and being part of the scene. And so perhaps in some ways that sort of skewed my understanding, because I don't think that's necessarily the reaction most people get when they show up here. This one's kind of an intense one. And this is one of my coworkers, actually. That was not the only story like that to come out to the Twitter replies. So amidst all of this, last week, people that I work with, did I put, there we go. This is where it starts to brighten up a little, guys. We just take it down and then we're gonna take it up. I didn't want anyone to leave here crying. So a few things. After all this was going down on Twitter, what you didn't see as part of all of this were the DMs, you know, the messages I was getting on Twitter, emails, Facebook, the kind of stories that people did not feel safe sharing at all, for understandable reasons. There also, you will see that most of the women who replied to me, if you can see their icons, most of them are white. I think there's still very much different consequences for women and people of color to specifically talk about their negative experiences in the music industry. There's more of a double bind, I believe. So amongst all of this, I started to get, aside from incredibly harrowing emails from women who were, you know, detailing about things like being treated for PTSD from a job working at an indie label where every day for years they were faced with graphic, misogynistic jokes and then just told, you know, it's just a joke, can't you take a joke? To women's experiences, you know, detailing sexual harassment and sexual assaults, you know, at the hands of people who are very famous, even. And amongst that, I was getting messages and emails and calls from men I knew, male colleagues, saying that their eyes had very much been opened and that they saw sometimes their own behavior in the things that women were, I don't want to say complaining about, voicing. And I was really heartened by that because sometimes this conversation feels incredibly cyclical. It is like a hamster wheel, you know, saying this is what happened to me. This guy was an asshole. The guy doing sound is an asshole in every story. And, sorry guys, I do know a nice sound guy, he's gay. And, you know, but like one of the things, I don't even know if we see it in here, but Night Jewel, who's like a fairly well-known recording artist, saying that, you know, complaining about sound guys messing with her sound when she rebuffed their sexual offers, which is like, wow, that's kind of next level. Maybe because you assume that once women get to a certain point, like that kind of sloughs off, but I guess we know from, did you guys read my interview with Bjork? It follows you to the top, I think. Anyway, so my friend, who is the man who's responsible for bringing me in at Pitchfork, my boss, Mike, he came to me and he said, you know, I thought I was a cool, self-aware dude, but reading these things, I realize I've done some of these things. I've had some of these attitudes, and I didn't even realize it. And another friend of mine wrote me sort of this, almost like a, you know, like as if he was querying an advice column saying, you know, I had a show last week, and you know, to load in, you had to go up a full flight of stairs. And I almost asked the woman if she wanted me to help carry her gear, but then I stopped myself. But then I also thought that would be the polite thing to do. And he details sort of his war, his inner war, about whether to offer to carry this woman's gear up a flight of stairs. And I was really heartened by those sort of queries that I was getting, that men were saying, what is my role in this? What is my part in this? I know that within music world, within music journalism, within all of this, there's a hierarchy that places men and especially male artists, up at the top. And that most people subscribe to that, to this idea of like the primacy of male art. And that that, above all, you know, the sanctity of it must be preserved. And when we do that, everybody else, especially women and their bodies, anyone who's not a white dude, we're just gonna real talk here, is they just go down the hierarchy. They get smaller. They get less important. And so the fact that men in my life and men that I work with were really seriously confronting this, that they were really considering, how do I stop this from happening? How do I stop participating in this? To me, it signals something. I feel like there's maybe something that's sort of like, we have broken through the ice. There's something undeniable about reading. We storified, do you guys know what that is? The first 400 replies that I got. And it takes you a few hours to read through those, and it is, if your eyes are not open by the end of it, I don't know what will help you. But I was really encouraged that there are men, and men in bands, men with power, who are trying to figure out how to create a system where people are kept safe at band shows. And can they do something like what Speedy Ortiz is doing? Do you guys know about that? The band Speedy Ortiz just in the last 2 days created basically a cell phone hotline where you can either text or call them if you are either being harassed or hurt or, you know, you're not safe at one of their shows. And I was talking to Sadie, who fronts Speedy Ortiz, last night, and she was saying that they've had dozens of bands contacting them saying, we want to do the same thing. We don't want people to be harassed or unsafe or hurt at our shows. And just the fact that men are asking, you know, can we do something that recognizes and changes how we're doing things, that recognize the fact that there are different ways that women, queer kids, trans people, people of color experience a space, experience crowds, experience being on stage, experience being in a pit, that they are different because of this particular hierarchy within music. You know, people are asking, what can we do as a club to show that we have a zero tolerance for women in particular, you know, being harassed at shows? You know, I trust that most of the men I know, I trust that people here in this room, you know, are good men, are good people, and that fundamentally, you know, the incredible importance of women's work and women's involvement in music. And surely you are people who hire women to run your shit, if you're smart. And I know there are many men who are saddened and frustrated by the state of things, the state of what these tweets have evidenced. And they want to fix it. And they are eager to hear how they can do it. And here's my advice, basically. And I hope you take it really seriously. Witness what is happening around you. Witness what women are up against. Ask the women you know about their experiences making music, playing music, performing, and attending shows. Listen to their answers, meaning, don't excuse somebody's behavior by saying, but he's a really good guy, or that doesn't sound like him, or you're taking something personally, or maybe you misunderstood that. Maybe that was just a joke. Oh, he has a weird sense of humor. That's always my favorite, right? Or, worst case, sometimes we hear, well, what did you expect? Which is basically saying, well, this is a man's world. We play by particular rules. And here's the most important part of all of this. When women tell you what their experiences are, believe them. And don't qualify that belief, just believe them. There are different ways to do this, and this is some rough suggestions. When you're on a conference call and some dude is talking over the woman who is speaking, you can interrupt him and say, "Hey, hold that thought for a minute. I want to hear what she's saying." You can co-sign a woman's idea on an email thread. As we know from my interview with Bjork, you know, sometimes you have to say things over and over and over before it registers with anyone. There is a lesser value on what women's opinions and communication are. Accept women's expertise. Hire female sound engineers in your club. Post signs in your venue that there's a zero tolerance policy for harassment, and then actually follow it up. Include sexual assault prevention training for all festival and security staff. This is actually a big movement that is happening in Canada right now in light of the Gian Gomeshi scandal. There's actually an organization there that works specifically with festivals and music venues. It is not difficult to do in your training for staff wherever you work. If you know a guy that you work with or who's around in your scene who has a skeezy rep, and maybe you know women who don't want to work with him or play on festivals with him, ask them what the deal is with that guy. What do they know? Because chances are, as we learned from the Gian Gomeshi scandal, lots of times people know that if a dude is skeezy, they don't necessarily want to ask, particularly if that guy has any amount of power at all, or could help your band, or could help your career. People don't want to look at that because it's inconvenient. Or maybe you can do things like don't invite Chris Brown to perform on your Grammys 3 or 4 times in a row. Don't ask R. Kelly to do a cameo on your rap album. I don't know if anyone here is going to do that. And here's a really basic thing you can do. Call out other dudes when you see them being shitty. Because lots of times they're not going to listen to us. We know that. But lots of times dudes listen to other dudes, especially if you are a dude with power. If you are someone who can help their career, they might want to take your advice. But most importantly, don't make us carry this burden alone. That is the most important part. Because when all of this happens to us, when we exist in an environment where there is a low-level casual sexism, there is a low-level, sometimes casual misogyny, when we are told what's happening to us isn't really happening, and if it is, please don't talk about it. The most important thing we can do is have this recognized, have it seen by other people who are in a position to help it stop. So I have a story, it's a little bit depressing, but I'm gonna tell it because this is an example of something that happened in Chicago where I live, about people who sort of just said, this is how it is, and accepted it. So about 10 years ago, there's a club by my house where at the time I practically lived. I was probably there 3-4 nights a week. And I heard this story. It was a very well-circulated story after it happened. A mid-level rap group on a tour, one night after a show, after their show, one of the barbacks goes outside, and they are, like 5-6 of them, I think, in this group, drunkenly running a train on a woman who is too wasted to stand up. And she's, you know, up against a dumpster, and one of them's holding her up. And the employee sees this and goes back and tells people what's happening, and no one does anything. And last year, a full decade later, this group is still playing this venue for probably the 6th time since then. Most of the women I know in the scene who've been around for more than a few years know this story. So what are we supposed to think? What does the message of that tell us? That we're not safe at that venue, maybe? That our bodies don't matter? That this is not a space where women count? Where women are a reward for a show well played? That is what happens. That is the message that happens when men do not stand up and say, this can't happen. And this is why we need anybody who is moved by a single one of these tweets to show up for women, to show up for the women at these shows, to show up for all of the women that have been so discouraged by their experiences and their encounters when they come into these spaces that they quit, that they stop going to shows, that they stop making music. We can't let that happen. And I believe we are in a time right now where people want that to change. You know? Who wants to be at a show that's a bunch of dudes? Who wants to be in a band that's a bunch of dudes? Who wants the women that are running their venues, their organizations, their booking agencies, to disappear because they can't take it anymore, what it's like around them, the hostility that they encounter, or just the small things that tell them every day that they don't really belong here, that they don't really count. I totally steered off course of what I was saying. I just freestyled that. I think music is a great equalizer in many ways. And I know all of us are here. Well, maybe some people are here because they like wanna make it. But everyone is here because music is your life. Right? And I think we need to value the lives and respect the lives and the bodies of everyone who is making it. Nobody should be mattering more than anyone else. And I hope we can all agree on that. That's basically all I have. I know that's less than my allotted time. Maybe, I don't know. For all I know, it's been 3 hours. I was told that there are microphones for the audience if anyone would like to ask a question. I would also like to invite anybody to share their own experience, sort of in the vein of some of the tweets that I posted, or anything that you are particularly proud of in terms of surviving and being here and sticking it out. Or if you just have a question, a regular old question.
Hi, Jessica, thank you so much for that. My name is Jen Kloer. I'm a songwriter and musician, and
I know who you are.
Wow, thanks. I guess I just wanted to say thank you, first of all, just for providing a space where these experiences can be affirmed. And I've just sat here and identified, you know, with those tweets. And I think often as a woman in the music community, you kind of just shrug it off or pretend that it's not happening or don't want to say anything or want to be one of the boys. And, you know, I've had a lot of experience turning up to live music venues and having a lot of women in my band, a female drummer, and having, you know, sound technicians tell us how to set up and how our sound should be, and certainly in the early days, you know. So it was just good to remember that. And yeah, I think it's just a really important conversation. So really I'm just saying thank you for being here. Thank you for opening up this conversation. And thank you for also giving us a few ideas and solutions around how we can, you know, look at it further. It's really important.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Erin. Again, I completely agree, and I'm really glad that you came and talked to us about this today. I guess I just wanted to share a little bit of my history. A few years ago, I moved interstate to study a course on an instrument, and there was only two of us in the course, and a man and myself. My nickname for the entire year was Bitch by this man. And toward the end of it, I thought it was my fault, and that I wasn't good enough to be there, and it kind of destroyed me. And then I moved on to the next thing and ended up quitting music for almost 3 years before I decided that I wanted to try again on a different instrument in a different scene with different people. But the next year there was only one other girl as well, and he ended up raping her, and she doesn't play music anymore, and he has quite a high profile in the scene that I was working in, and he's still teaching that course, favouring men, and it's kind of really obvious as to why women shy away from that scene, I guess. So thanks for speaking up. I really appreciate it, and it means a lot.
Thank you for sharing that. I'm glad you're here.
Hi, Jessica. Just amazing. I'm over here.
In the darkness.
Hey, sorry. Just amazing talk. Thank you so much. I wanted to ask you a question. On my way here, I ran into someone and told them that I was coming to see you. And they said, sorry, my voice sounds all shaky.
Me too.
They said, oh yeah, I don't want to go see that because she's just going to talk about females and women and feminism. And I don't think that's good. I don't think we should be only concentrating on feminism because it's about equality. What would you say to someone who... And I was a bit put off and ran away from him quickly. So what would you say to people like that?
Well, I'm glad my rep precedes me. So far it's working out really well for me to primarily be talking about women and females and feminism. My book came out in May, and it just went into its fourth pressing. You can tell your friend that if you want. Doing nails emoji. So there's that. Well, you know, the whole rest of the world speaks to men's concerns, so hopefully your friend will have their needs met. Feminism is about equality. I believe my feminism originates from a place of love, because I think what feminism does is it not only liberates women from the sort of prescribed cliches of how we are supposed to be in this world, or more often than not be, but it also does the same for men. I feel like my feminism doesn't just speak to women. And that, you know, feminism is basically the idea that men and women deserve the same respect and treatment. And so I think that way it very much does regard men. But I also don't have a ton of time to try to explain to people that don't get it. And that's my feeling. Thank you for being here.
Hi, I really enjoyed your talk. Really important to me. I'm running into so many guys these days, and same as that other speaker, sort of trying to say that feminism is dead, and I'm just like, what the fuck are you talking about? And I was in the punk scene and hardcore scene for like 20 years, and when we used to have big dances and stuff, we had heaps of women on the floor dancing with us, and they were the wickedest slam dancing sessions, and they're like a giant fucking group hug. And like, I've been going to like the Crowbar a couple of times to heavier gigs, and it's just a bunch of really heavy set blokes smashing the shit out of each other. And like, if you know these guys, can you kind of or maybe point out to them that actually is like that kind of slam dancing can be really cool, fun way to dance, but it has to be, there's rules and it's got to be gentler and things like that. Like, just something I thought to add to the talk today.
I appreciate you fighting for an inclusive pit. It's a real thing. It's a real thing. When I was, 15, 16, growing up and going to punk shows in Minneapolis at First Avenue, maybe you know that venue from Princess Purple Rain movie. And I used to carry, I had this old Nikon camera. I used to take pictures of the bands and shows that I went to put in my fanzine, my little Xerox fanzine that I made at the copy shop. And I would kind of like put it inside like a, you know, some sort of padded thing. But then I had an old metal lunchbox that I regularly used as a weapon in the pit, basically. I don't think anybody does that anymore, but it's a real thing. When I was young, I really wanted to be right there and like as close as I could get and like, you know, be totally overtaken by the music that I loved. And I was going to a lot of punk and hardcore shows primarily. And I really just, you know, eventually you're just like, oh, someone just shoved me like 25 feet. Like this is, you know, sometimes the violent, one of the writers that writes for me at Pitchfork just wrote something, I think the title of it, everyone in this room, please read it, called, I Wasn't Born Here, I Was Brought Here, maybe? How I Survived Punk Long Enough to Discover Afropunk. And it was a very long title. Not mine. But that he talks about going to punk shows and being in the pit or seeing the pit from above and being one of two men of color in the entire pit and how it was the violence of the pit felt much weightier. Just being, you know, a black man in America where violence is a threat all the time. Everyone please read that piece and consider that next time you're in the pit. Are there any other questions? I see pointing, I see a hand, I see a man.
Hi, thanks for the chat, the conversation, that was really, really great. I just wanted to probably make a comment and get your thoughts on it. I'm a hip hop artist and I suppose in the last few years, probably the last 3 or 4 years, I've come to the, you know, I've had my, I suppose, mind opened up, my eyes opened up to misogyny and sexism, and that was actually because dating a girl and to hear her perspective on life and the music scene and how she feels in her job and her career and how she feels treated. And that, honestly, I probably wasn't that male white privilege bubble. I didn't understand any of that. Like, I wasn't a perpetrator of it myself, but I wasn't really switched on to how, you know, it was for a woman. And I suppose what I wanted to say is, as a hip hop artist, especially, I think what's I've become more conscious of now is lyrical content and how, not just in hip hop, but in music in general, this, I suppose, this culture of misogyny and sexism can be perpetrated through lyrics, and even artists who themselves might not identify as, you know, being a sexist or someone who would maybe off stage they actually treat women with respect, but they are, you know, contributing to that culture through their music. And I think that's something that, you know, people need to speak out on and say, no, I'm actually not going to support that, because you know, the music you're making is not going to be helpful to my sister, my girlfriend, my mother, etc.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Whoever just sent that tweet that said I have the best keynote, you gotta know, I'm super competitive. I really appreciate what you're saying. You know, something that I actually was really deeply involved in the emo scene, sort of at its early initial crest, perhaps. I was the publicist for, you know, Jimmy Eat World and At the Drive-In and Alkaline Trio and Promise Ring and the entire Jade Tree Records catalog and a bunch of Discord bands. So I was involved in the popularization of emo, a scene where there were like 4.5 women, and I was one of them. And I had this revelation about emo that then became like the sort of cornerstone of a piece that I wrote that's probably the piece that I'm writing that I'm best known for, called Emo Where the Girls Aren't. And I realized something, that sometimes you don't necessarily have to be singing like, whatever, fuck you bitch, that you can perpetuate things simply by the omission of women in some ways. And what was sort of this linchpin realization about emo was that the lyrics, I realized, weren't just descriptive, that maybe they were prescriptive by saying women can only be muses by their being girlfriends and, you know, not even meriting names when they were in songs. It's sort of, I was like, does this tie to the fact that they're like, we don't see any women on stage and we only see women in the front row? That between these songs and between this scene, suddenly we think that maybe young girls, this is the first time they're coming to the show, and you know, that maybe they came into emo through like Dashboard Confessional, and they're kind of digging down because this music is exciting to them. And they're gonna get here and just go, oh, my job is to be in the audience because I don't see other examples of how to be or where to be or where I fit. And so I think those are really, I really appreciate the fact that you're considering that and considering that in the scope of your career, and then also that you listened and believed, you know, this woman's account of her experience of her life as an artist. I think that's really valuable. I think that is truly the first step to things changing. Do we have time for any more questions? There you go.
Thank you so much, Jess. And thank you for having the tweet wall, because, you know, Twitter is often used as a bullying mechanism for a lot of women in the industry.
Yes.
My name's Kim Tan, and I'm a venue and band booker, and the gross tweet I could probably put up there is that people are always like, oh, it starts with a B, not an H. Anyway, the point that you made about the guy that you knew who wanted to help the female artist carry the stuff, and then he was reckoning with himself, like, is this patronizing or not? And you're encouraging of having the conversations out there. I had actually a friend, she's a sports journalist, and she's a very big music fan, had a bit of difficulty with a man in the music industry that she knew from gigs. And she actually had sat down, got him for a coffee, and had a conversation with him, and he realized, oh, I didn't know that this was the reputation I was building, that kind of thing. For a little while, she actually had to reckon, because he started engaging with feminism. It actually made her really angry that he had started to do this, because in a way, for her, it felt like it was tokenistic. But I'm wondering, like, there are women out there, you yourself, if, like, reckoning with those feelings, like, in a way, I thought it was so positive that he was engaging with it, and it was the first steps towards, you know, himself realizing what's out there and maybe being able to call out other guys. What do you think about that?
I don't say there's no wrong way to go about it, but I mean, if people are interested in changing their participation and their part and their way of being within music and their way of treating women. You know, I think it's to be encouraged. I think sometimes, you know, we get really eager about things and suddenly we're an expert and we want a pat on the back for being an ally, you know. But I generally think if people are really genuinely interested in trying to change how things are, and if they are willing to listen, they don't need to necessarily come up with like the solution, but just to listen and take in what other people's experiences are and be empathetic and think about their role in those things. I mean, that's a really pretty fundamental start. I hope that happens for people.
Again, thanks, Jessica. Nick Cooper from Music Victoria. Thanks
Hello.
For coming. Hi. Can I just say from my own personal experience that there's nothing simpler than having a conversation or saying a couple of sage words to somebody that you can see is doing the wrong thing. And quite recently for me, I had one of those experiences where I was sitting there with another male friend who's a great musician from Melbourne, and we noticed this behaviour going on this dance floor at a well-attended popular Melbourne venue, and it was just really poor human behaviour. It was some guy dancing around a group of girls and touching them, not inappropriately it was definitely inappropriately because it was touching them without their permission, you know, but basically his friend bounced over to us because he saw that we were looking at him. He said, "Hey guys, how's it going?" Trying to smooth it over straight up. And we said, "Oh, what's going on over there? Your friend, is that your friend?" And he goes, yeah, he's okay. You know, he's exactly what you said before. Funny sense of humor, he's a character, whatever it is. It's like, what he's doing is not okay. Would you like to tell him or would you like us to tell him? And his face changed instantly. And he knew exactly what we were getting at. And you could tell that he had seen that behavior before. And he called his friend over and we sat down and had the best conversation for half an hour. And these two guys walked out of this venue, basically with their tails between their legs, but also knowing that we said something to them they needed to hear. And it's so simple. And I haven't felt better for doing something in a long time than having gone through that. And I encourage anyone to do it, male or female, but especially males.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that story. Thank you for, that's holding people to account. Sometimes it is quite simple. Yes, thumbs up. Agreed, also a thumb up. Do we have time for one more question? I can't see. There's a hand, or is that a neck?
Hey.
Perhaps it is both.
I have a question. When you quit a job because everybody's behavior towards you is incredibly sexist, afterwards you might want to speak out about it, but there's this fear that speaking out might make you unemployable in future. Beyond employers being less jackassy about these things, is there a solution to that?
Is that you, Laura?
Yes, hi.
Laura Snapes, senior editor of the Pitchfork Review, contributing editor at Pitchfork. Someone who makes my life so much better. And writer I admire. Yes, there is, I think that is one of the things that, we keep quiet about stuff because of those same consequences, because of that fear, and because sometimes the people who are perpetrating these things are powerful and their predation on other people or their abuse of other people is allowed to continue because of the power they wield and because we all want to have careers doing what we love. And that can hang over us. It's hard to say. Does someone want to get that? Am I out of time? Is this someone's subtle hint? I have 5 minutes remaining. Thanks, technology. It's tempting to say, be fearless, go for it. You know, don't let that person hang over you. That is not realistic because we know there are consequences to all of that stuff. You know, we've had colleagues that have been like doxxed and abused on the internet and people who've been exiled within the music industry for being loud about things. But at the same time, I don't want to tell anybody to stay quiet about anything, you know? Because it it's hard to say, like, well, you know, you're just helping perpetuate it. I hope that people are ready to be open and hear about women's experiences and what they really have to say about what it's like to do the work they do and like what they have to endure sometimes just to do their job that they love. What is my advice? It's hard because I've done both things, you know. I've been really quiet about all manner of things because, same thing, I want to be employable, or I don't want something that happened to me, you know, to follow me around. I don't want people to gossip about it or talk about it or suggest that, like, I did something to bring it on myself, you know? And at the same time, you know, I'm fortunate that people listen when I talk, and so when I say, oh, this thing sucks, or this is going wrong, lots of times people go, oh, yes, thank you, good job, you're speaking the truth. But if I was somebody's intern, it's doubtful anybody might even listen to me, especially if I was at the start of my career. My advice would be, do whatever you need to do to honor your own interest and relationship with music. If you are in a situation where how someone's treating you is like killing your ability to like write or believe in yourself or do music or sustain it, just get out of it. That's sort of like the only practical solution I know. And call them out if that feels like a even moderately safe thing to do, or at least tell other people, warn other people. I don't know. I wish I had a better answer. Thank you for your question, Laura. There's 2 minutes and 10 seconds left if anyone has some sort of like speed round, final question, in summation. Hand.
Hello. Hello. My name's Melissa O'Donovan, and there's many things that I could say, because I've had a lot of thoughts since you were talking, but I have a 10-year-old daughter, and I called her Arusha Beal, and, sorry, I'll just take a breath, because my heart is now beating. So Arusha is from the Maasai tribe, and it means confident, creative, and ambitious, and that's because I really hold that hope, especially for women. And I called her Beal as a middle name because that means mouth in Irish. And I find that with a woman, when you don't have the same standing in society, perhaps you don't have the same access to education, this conversation is happening within the music industry, but actually it is a cultural problem. It is a same conversation that happens in the performing arts industry, in the architecture industry. They're the same experiences. It's the same ingrained misogyny across the entire world. And I like to take that macro perspective because people within this industry are not alone, and it cannot be changed from only within the music industry. The people who are working in the industry also have to understand their role all across our living culture and across all of our lives throughout the day and night. But I thought having a daughter that was encouraged to be confident, creative, and ambitious with her mouth might be something that would assist our future, where we don't have to compete in a physical, in a body, and have a body that's commodified, that we can have that intelligence and that expression through our creative ability. So thank you everybody for being here, and thank you for the conversation.
Thank you. We are out of time, but also I have nothing to add. That was perfect point to end on. Thank you everyone for coming. am on a panel with Laura Snapes in like 34 minutes somewhere else in this building. Will you join us, please? It's about writing. Good afternoon.